Well, good afternoon, and welcome to Burford Church this afternoon for our service on Good Friday. We're particularly remembering that final hour of the Lord Jesus' earthly life before he gave up his spirit and died. This afternoon, our aim really is just to read two chapters of John's Gospel that we might hear once again and afresh, we pray, all of that the Lord Jesus did in giving up his life, those final hours as we go from his betrayal and arrest through crucifixion, having been through a sham of a trial. There'll be times of quiet where we can reflect and maybe want to reread some of the readings, maybe want to spend some time in prayer. There'll be some music that I hope will also help us as we seek to look to the Lord Jesus at this time and remember his sacrifice for us. Well, as we begin together, let us pray our opening prayer that you see on our service sheet or will come up on the screen if you're watching from home. Together we pray. King of glory, we adore you, our Saviour and Lord. You suffered on the cross and gave your life as a ransom for many. We bless and thank you for the outpouring of your love and offer our worship today out of unspeakable gratitude. Amen. Our first song points us and leads us as we come underneath the cross of the Lord Jesus.
We fall away.
The purpose of John's Gospel is that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, we might have life in his name. So our prayer this afternoon is that each of us might know more deeply, or maybe even for the first time, the life that we might receive by knowing Jesus as the Christ. We begin in the garden in John 18. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it that you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas, the traitor, was standing with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. If you're looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Then the detachment of soldiers with its commander and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it would be good if one man died for the people. John 11 tells us the story of Lazarus and how he was raised. And that was a turning point in the gospel where from that time onwards people would plot to kill the Lord Jesus. That's when Caiaphas first spoke those words that it would be good if one man would die for the nation, for all people. Caiaphas was speaking more than he knew. For indeed, the one Jesus would die for all people to bring them to God. A few moments for quiet prayer.
Courtyard, but Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the servant girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" she asked Peter, and he replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and officials stood round a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter also was standing with them, warming himself. Meanwhile, the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. "I have spoken openly to the world," Jesus replied, I always taught in the synagogues or at the temple where all the Jews come together. I said nothing in secret. Why question me? Ask those who heard me. Surely they know what I said. When Jesus said this, one of the officials nearby slapped him in the face. Is this the way you answer the high priest? He demanded. If I said something wrong, Jesus replied, testify as to what is wrong. But if I spoke the truth, why did you strike me? Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there, warming himself. So they asked him, you aren't one of his disciples too, are you? He denied it, saying, I am not. One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, challenged him, didn't I see you with him in the garden? Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, a cock began to crow.
Let me lead us in a prayer of confession. Loving God, we know that you love us, so we confess that we have let you down. Each day we betray you when we are selfish or unkind. We deny you when we do not speak out for justice and truth, or for even owning your name. We misunderstand you when we justify our actions and we misquote what you have said. Lord, there are many ways in which we have fallen short. We are truly sorry and look to you and to your cross for mercy. Amen. A moment of quiet for each of us to bring particular things for which we want to repent and bring them to the foot of the cross. Lord Jesus Christ, betrayed for 30 pieces of silver, deserted by your disciples, denied by Peter, mocked by Herod, whipped by Pilate, crowned with thorns, and nailed to the cross, we humbly and with all our heart thank you for your suffering and death, by which each of us can be forgiven and are redeemed. Amen.
Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice. You became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life. I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you, once again I pour out my life.
Then the Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourself and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," they objected. This took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king, then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. With this, he went out again to the Jews gathered there and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in an uprising.
It was a sham, and it was total injustice. And so let us pray for those facing injustice in our own land and our world today. Father God, we pray for those facing great injustice, those who are oppressed by power, by wealth, by education, convenience, and in so many other ways. Well, we read in the gospel accounts of Jesus in your word, we see the wicked-hearted Pharisees and Sadducees, the crowd that chose Barabbas, and the Roman soldiers who carried out their orders without thinking about the injustice. No one knows the depths of injustice better than you, our Lord, and we know that change needs to start within our own hearts. So please open our hearts and the hearts of many, that we may see people the way that you see them, that you may love people the way that you love people. Help us to acknowledge wrongs. Give us clear minds and hearts to see the truth behind injustice. In your name we pray. Amen. Prayer for those affected by injustice. Lord, please draw near to all those who are affected by injustice, who are affected by wickedness and evil. Remind us of your closeness and your presence, and remind us that you are with us always. Your word tells us that you are the light, and though the darkness tries, it cannot put out the light. Your word also tells us that darkness is as light to you. You know all things. There is no secret that can be kept from you. You know the truth of all that has happened. The Psalms remind us that you are a refuge in the midst of our trials. You are our everlasting fortress, our only and true safe place. So may we leave every tear and every ache of our heart at your feet. May we trust you with these realities and know that you are sovereign over all, that you are a just God and that you will right every wrong. Help us to trust you and find comfort in your sovereignty, we pray. Amen. A prayer for unity in the face of injustice. Lord, we respond in many different ways. Whether it be anger, confusion, or hurt. And may we know that each of us is made to be your image bearer, with no one more important than another. You look at each of your children and have compassion and love towards each one of us equally. Help us to love as you do, to help us see one another as you do. Help us to forgive one another in the midst of injustice. Lord, may we be more like you, who turned to the thief on the cross who mocked you and forgave him and led him to everlasting life. Lord Jesus, you looked out at a hateful crowd and had compassion and said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Lord, please give us that kind of compassion, love, and grace. Lord God, you offer everlasting life to any that believe in you. That any believe that you died for sinners, of which we all are, and you paid our penalty of death with the sacrifice of your life. You washed us clean. And your resurrection has provided a way for all who believe to know you and be loved by you. We praise that you've brought us into your family, each one equal inheritors of the kingdom of God. And so we look forward to that life, a life without sin, without injustice, pain, anger, and sorrow, So, Lord, we thank you for that hope today. May our hearts be ignited by your truth. Lead us to speak your truth in grace and love. Bring hope to the brokenhearted. Help us to seek justice, but leave vengeance to you. And light the way to your kingdom, that many more can see and believe with transformed hearts and minds that you are who you say you are. And we ask all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and for his glory. Amen. The trial continues. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they slapped him in the face. Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they cried, "Crucify! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." But the Jewish leaders insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. He went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus. But Jesus gave no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You'd have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jewish leaders kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king is no friend of Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the Stove Pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him!" "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. So finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
Thank you. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but that this man claimed to be King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. This garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled that said, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." So this is what the soldiers did. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to them, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home.
So if John's gospel is written that we may believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that by believing him we might have life in his name, John is adding to the picture throughout this narrative. We've seen time and time again that word fulfilled, how in chapter 18, verse 8, this was to fulfill that he would not lose anyone. Verse 32, that it would fulfill the kind of death that Jesus would have. It fulfilled the fact that they would divide his clothes. We see the authority and the control of Jesus throughout this thing. This is therefore no tragic accident. We see Jesus' authority as he says, "I am," in chapter 18, verse 5, as they come to arrest him, and they all fall back and fall down. Then in verse 11, he knows that he must drink the cup. He knows about Peter's denial. He knows that he has a kingdom, but it's just not of this world. He knows that Pilate has no authority unless it were allowed from above. So throughout this narrative, we see Jesus knows who he is. He knows what he's doing. He knows the plan that he and the Lord God had planned before eternity. And Jesus is heading towards the cross. But why is it? It is, as John would tell us, that we might have life by believing in his name. And his death and resurrection brings life to all who would believe. To those who see their need of sins forgiven, he offers life. And as we reflect on what the Lord Jesus did in those final hours, our question is, who will be our Christ? Christ means anointed king. Is it the king that God has anointed, the Lord Jesus, or is it some other king? Do we choose another? Because the religious choose another. The religious leaders of Jesus' day do not want Jesus to be the king. They've seen the claim that Jesus is the Son of God, which is John's great desire, that we might see that he's the Son of God, and they choose Caesar. They see his claim and choose Caesar. They push Pilate to say that anyone that is a friend of Jesus is no friend of Caesar. They make Caesar their Christ, and they put the Lord Jesus on the cross. And the Caesar that they turn to is one who is not interested in truth. He knows the truth, and yet he will kill just one more. Barabbas, the guilty, is freed, and Jesus, the innocent, is killed anyway. But what of the King of the Jews? Will he be our Christ? The one who from the cross would ask his friend to care for his mother, for his mother to care for his friend, who would in the upper room wash feet, including the ones of Judas, the traitor. His concern is for God's glory, for his friends. For God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. That was what drove the Lord Jesus. Do we want a king who is concerned only for injustice, or a king who is one of love? What does having Jesus as our king look like? Well, as we look ahead, we see Joseph and Nicodemus do what they can. When all hope appears to have gone, Joseph comes out of the woodwork and lovingly cares for the one he knows is his Lord. Nicodemus, who had been in the dark, comes to the light. At great financial expense, but also at risk to reputation, it means serving him where we can. In the face of Roman injustice, in the face of religious pride and control, but in the face of the love of Christ, for Joseph and Nicodemus, it was a risk worth taking. Who is our Christ? Let us pause and reflect as our next song is played.
Stripped of majesty, he hangs disfigured on a tree. A man of grief by man betrayed, like one from whom we turn away. Led like a lamb without a sound, crown.
later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the leg of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it and has given testimony, and his testimony is true, he knows that he tells the truth and testifies that you may believe. These things happened so the Scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another Scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and alloys and 35 kilograms. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. The place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid, because it was a Jewish day of preparation. And since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Merciful God, you have made all people, and hate nothing that you have made, nor you desire the death of sinners, but rather they should be converted and live. Have mercy on all people and those that do not know you, who deny the faith of Christ crucified. Take from all ignorance, hardness of heart, and contempt for your word, and bring each home to your fold, that we may all become one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our final song encourages us to continue reflecting on the cross, that we might boast only in his death, that we might see his love, and then offer our very lives as we leave and seek to serve him.
Oh,
know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. So may you find in the cross a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And may the blessing of God go with you now and forevermore. Amen.